everybody. We are back to play some Call of Juarez, Gunslinger again. Let's go. Let's go. We're now at the start of chapter 4. And it should, like, start quite intense, because there's a shootout.
I dodged death many a time, and that night in Abilene was no good.
Damn, he's fast.
I was there with the intention of finding that bastard Bob and collecting the bounty on John Wesley.
I thought the Texas Rangers got heart.
Yeah, that's what they want you to believe. It was cold in a witch's tit and a brass bra that night as I fought my way past his loyal compadres. To the very same saloon we're sitting in today. Look around and imagine this place painted in blood. Hardin was waiting for me, and... Wait, I'm jumping the gun here. Let me back up and give you some background on this sumbitch. He deserves that much. Don't you think so, Ben? John Wesley Hardin was a killer. By the end, he confessed to taking the lives of 42 men.
I really like all the
fathers and husbands, brothers and sons, men with families who cared about them. He was a bona fide folk hero by then, and had amassed a gang of armed miscreants and other assorted thugs. He and his men set up camp outside of town, and I was hoping Bob was among them.
Shit, it's cold out here. I'm freezing my giblets off.
Shoot that son of a bitch!
They didn't ask why I was there. They knew. As most of them were wanted as well. I figured Hardin was here somewhere, but to get to him, I'd have to get past his gun hands. And that was easier said than done, as most of them were as foolish and full of bravado as I was. To spill a lot of blood to find out Hardin wasn't in that camp. He was carousing in town with his closest friends. Hardin's boys apparently didn't want me to reach the Bull's Head. Some were hightailing it into town to inform their jefe of my unwelcomed presence.
Get me!
I wondered if Bob was among them. and I steeled myself for the fight ahead. For as good as I was, deep down I wondered if John Wesley wasn't just a little bit better. Before I could test my mettle against Harden, however, I would first need to dispatch his cadre of hired killers. Most of these degenerates were beyond redemption, but John Wesley might have been a different story. That night was, in fact, his birthday celebration. I already mentioned that I found Harden in this very saloon. Suffice it to say, nobody there was happy to see me. In fact, I felt a certain hostility. I was disappointed that neither Bob nor John Wesley were among the dead. But that was short-lived, as a moment later I was facing down the fastest gun in the West. I felt a bolt of adrenaline, or maybe that was fear. He was well known for his tricks, and I knew I'd need my own if I was ever to defeat him.
No, wait. He didn't hit me then. I'm sure of it.
Those duels are not quite easy.
That man was faster than grease lightning, but being inebriated as he was, he didn't count his shots. And now, he was at my mercy.
So he didn't die?
No, I sent him to prison. Years later, after he was free, some restless avenger took his life. Shot him in the back in a saloon just like this one. Anybody up for another beer? Ben?
I'm down for another beer. I'm dead.
Thank you, darling. Yeah, some say revenge is a dish best served cold.
So whatever happened to that Bob guy you were after?
Personally, I'd like to hear some of your other adventures. Like, I don't know, do you ever go toe-to-toe with a red man?
Episode 5.
Yes, I did, Ben. I remember once I was after this renegade Apache, Grey Wolf. Strangely enough, revenge was also his primary motivation. A bounty was put on Grey Wolf's head, and that's how I came to hunt him in the mountains. Mountains so high, they tickled the nether regions of heaven. Grey Wolf was a Chiricahua Apache medicine man who had led a war party in revenge for a massacre against his people. The U.S. Army had attacked his tribe during his daughter's sacred sunrise ceremony, and the slaughter was unspeakable. I understood his anger, as there's nothing more traumatic than seeing those you love die in a cruel and painful death. Right from the beginning, I couldn't shake the feeling that Grey Wolf was watching my every move. He led a band of young Apache warriors who wanted retribution and were more than willing to die for him. They saw me before I saw them. Crossed my mind that maybe this wasn't such a good idea. But now that the shooting had started, there was no backing down. It was rugged country, the winter home of the Chiricahuas, and that's why they had retreated there. I admit to having some regrets about going after them the way I did, but then again, I got a lot of those. Not at that moment, but I did find the entrance to their hideout. That led to a deeper cave.
Don't tell me you went in there.
Yeah, but it's not out of bravery so much as pure, angry cussedness. See, back then, I had a stubborn streak a mile wide, and I wasn't about to back down.
So it was like pitch black in there?
Actually, it was pretty well lit, as they had torches on the walls.
Was his cave?
Big as hell, Ben. Chiricahua had hid out there during the Indian Wars. They thought it was haunted with the ghosts of those murdered by the horse soldiers.
The cave was haunted with dead Indian ghosts?
To be honest, I was more concerned with the live ones than the dead ones.
You know so much about engines.
A few years back, I was married to two Mescalero women.
At the same time?
Yeah, they were sisters. Polygyny is traditional among the Mescalero.
So what happened?
Oh, I had to get out of there. Those girls never shut up. Both of them nagging at me all the time. Drove me half crazy. Haven't seen them since.
No, I mean, what happened with Grey Wolf?
Oh, well, I pursued him into the Cave of Death. I came upon this flooded grotto, and that's when I saw him. He came to me unarmed and unafraid. His voice echoed in the shadows, and I sensed he meant me no harm.
You carry great darkness in your heart, and if you do not release it, it will claim your soul.
The sound of his voice put some kind of ancient Indian spell on me. As his story unfolded in my mind.
You will come to this place again and kill many more men, and the darkness will grow until it consumes everything that you are. The soul would have no rainbow if the eye had no tears.
He said I was a great warrior, a coyote man, unequaled by any other pale-faced warrior, or something like that.
The snakes will bite shadows of your past until a venom poisons your heart, and an echo of the song of the dead summons the spirits deep from within the mountains.
I didn't quite get what he was saying, but there was definitely snakes. And indeed, his warriors surrounded me and attacked me like hungry wolverines. They couldn't stop me, though, and Grey Wolf wasn't in the mood for idle talk. I swear I couldn't see any way out of this trap. But suddenly, one just appeared. Kinda like a miracle. I felt like I would be lost in that damn cave forever. Finally, I found myself back outside, perched on the edge of a precipice, overlooking a thundering whitewater river. To get where I was going required several leaps of faith, but no way in hell I was turning back. Chased after him, determined to make him explain the meaning of all that mumbo jumbo.
Mumbo jumbo's right. Are you making this all up as you go?
A few details may be fuzzy, brother, but I am relating exactly what happened to me. There were dozens of Apache warriors aiming at me from on high.
Dozens?
Well, maybe not a dozen, but there was a lot of them.
At least three or four.
Well, more than that, little lady. Steep climb up creek ahead of me and scrambled up those rocks like a mountain goat. I was determined to locate Grey Wolf and find out exactly what the hell he was trying to tell me. And wouldn't you know it, that crafty son of a bitch led me right into a trap.
What kind of trap?
Well, son, there had to be at least 100 Apaches around me.
100?
God be my witness.
Oh, come on. Who are you kidding?
Hey, I believe you. Come on, tell us how it ended.
All right, but I'm not gonna drag this out. Where were we?
You were surrounded by 100 Apache warriors.
Well, I didn't take the time to count them exactly, but there were a lot of them. And in the end, a path appeared before me that I had not seen before. I followed it as I desperately needed to find out what Grey Wolf was trying to tell me. But it was like that son of a bitch disappeared into thin air. Never did find him. And never did collect my goddamn bounty. Thank you, darling. It's interesting how the truth can sometimes seem, malleable, depending upon your point of view.
Like how those dime novels make you out to be something you're not?
Jack, don't be starting trouble.
No, he's right. They do tend to exaggerate.
Did they exaggerate your part in taking down the Daltons?
Well, I was there in the flesh, boy, so I saw what happened firsthand. Those Daltons were lawmen once, before they all went bad, robbing banks and trains clear across the territory, until Coffeyville, of course. I was one of the citizens who took up arms that day.
Fighting on the side of the right?
I did my best, sir. We all did. It was early morning. One of my friends was a local gunsmith, and he handed out firearms to anybody who'd take one. You see, the Daltons got it in their heads to rob two banks at the same time. Two banks on the same damn street. Bob Dalton's girl was always riding him about how he had no ambition. Well, you're nobody next to Jesse James, she'd say. Finally, the bastard took his brothers to Coffeyville just to shut her up. Well, the locals recognized the Daltons right off. Before they could get away, half the town took up arms to defend their property. Their first mistake was pulling a job in their own damn hometown.
Put some holes in them!
We've got...
The brothers paid dearly for their stupidity. But everybody knows... they had it coming.
There's more to it than that. I read all about that day, so I know for a fact that it went down very differently. First of all, it was high noon. A posse of U.S. deputy marshals were on the rooftop across the street.
Get ready, boys. They're gonna make a move.
The lawmen had been tracking the Daltons for months, and now they finally had them dead to rights. Among them was a bounty hunter feared by many a lawbreaker. This man had no intention of letting the Daltons slip away. The marshals tried to get the Daltons to surrender.
They'll give up eventually. We just gotta wait till something reaches out.
This bounty hunter knew that the brothers were far too proud to ever lay down their guns. He went in there alone to confront those criminals.
One of the marshals shouted, "Where are you going? Are you crazy?"
"Hey, where do you think you're going, dumbass? That rifle's mine."
He saw a way to get around to the back of the bank. Then he figured out how to hit the Daltons from a direction they weren't expecting. From above. Fortunately, a water tower was right there. A moment later, he was climbing up a steep ladder, laughing at danger as he did. It was brave men like him who risked their lives to tame this wild country.
We've got company.
Heroic men like him, who did what other men couldn't or wouldn't to make this country free. Like Jim Bowie, Davy Crockett, who died defending the Alamo.
Is that Silas Greaves? Son of a bitch!
Greaves, and when the dust finally settled, he was the last man standing.
Yeah.
Sorry, kid, but that just wasn't the way it happened.
Damn, that's what's not always happened.
It was early evening, not high noon.
That's it for you.
Daltons blew up a safe, and we're all set to hightail it out of there. I was late to the party, and Coffeyville was already up in arms. Those pathetic deputies surrounding the bank were dropping like flies. I had been tracking those jokers for months, waiting for them to do something reckless. And finally, they did. Those stupid bastards decided to rob two banks at the same time in the same town where everybody knew them. But they still had friends in Coffeyville.
Damn!
Hey, we got us.
Those friends came after me like a pack of wild dogs, tooth and nail. They were coming at me from all directions. I caught sight of the Daltons running with the money and didn't want to lose them. Problem was, they knew the town better than I did. To top it off, I found myself in the middle of another shootout entirely.
Did the Daltons hole up in somebody's house?
No, it was the Smiths, I believe. They were cousins of the Daltons. And they were shooting at the Browns, who were shooting at the Daltons. Which wasn't any surprise, since those two families have been feuding forever. And since the Joneses are related to the Browns, they shot at the Smiths, pissing off the Heimhoffers, whose daughter recently married Smith. Well, bullets were flying every which way as all the old feuds in Kansas caught fire all at once. There was a hell of a lot of pissed off people in Coffeyville that day. But that's just the way life is sometimes. Shit happens. Boys knew I would never give up. Those Daltons weren't the sharpest knives in the drawer, but they always stood together. They set a trap to slow me down and allow at least two of them to escape. The third brother stayed behind to plant me, just in case that trap of theirs didn't work. Determined to protect his brothers. I understood how it felt. Taking me on all by his lonesome wasn't exactly a recipe for a long life.
But Emmett Dalton survived the robbery in Coffeyville. He's the only Dalton who did.
They say he was shot 23 times.
Well, Dwight, who do you think put all those damn holes in him? But I have to admit, that boy had grit.
Suckers.
It took me a couple of days to track the Daltons down.
They can't get away with this!
And in that time, a whole posse of local vigilantes offered to lend a hand.
track him to the ends of the earth.
They seemed as determined as me to find those outlaws. But as we headed into those swamps, it was like I had my own private army. There was no way those boys were getting away this time.
It was early fall, right? Beautiful time of year. At least you had the weather on your side.
Not by my recollection. It was damp and foggy as hell. It was tough to stay on a true course, so we kept an eye out for landmarks. It was autumn. The maple trees were in full color, red as blood. The rains that year were torrential, so the whole area was flooded. The vigilantes had spread out wide, and pretty soon I couldn't see anybody. Except for some sumbitches ahead of me wanted to do me harm, so I had to face them alone. I wondered why my compatriots didn't come running when they heard the shots.
So did you find the Daltons?
Not yet, but I did have the questionable pleasure of meeting a few of their friends. The boys had established quite a reputation by that time, so they attracted all manner of riffraff to their cause. Point being, I was under serious attack, and my reinforcements was nowhere to be seen.
Somebody kill that sumbitch!
But luckily, a barn materialized as if right before my eyes. I scrambled up top to get a better view. But just ended up falling inside.
So, how did you get out?
The barn doors was open. About right then, I saw some suspicious characters running through the bushes. Of course, I followed them. That goddamn swamp was like a goddamn maze, and pretty soon I had no goddamn idea where I was. Steve, So I just started walking, and pretty soon Steve? Steve?
No, I'm listening.
Indians surrounded me from all sides.
There were Indians?
No. I just wanted to make sure Steve was paying attention. Now, where was I?
You were following the Daltons through a swamp?
That's right. See, Steve? Dwight's paying attention.
No, I'm listening. I was just resting my eyes.
So, where was I?
The Daltons.
Right. See, there's a reason so many outlaw gangs are made up of brothers. Being a brother is a very sacred thing.
Stop that!
It's a bond like no other.
So did you ever find the damn Daltons?
Not yet. But I did find a few of their cousins. You cans breed like rabbits. More Smiths or Heimhoffers or who knows what. But hell, what's more important than family? I bet Ben knows what I'm talking about. Boys were out there somewhere, standing together against anyone who would threaten them. And that's when I saw it. A goddamn steamboat.
A steamboat? In a swamp?
Yeah, Steve, but this wasn't much more than a wreck, really.
But how'd a damn steamboat end up in the swamps?
Guess it floated off during the flood of 89.
Now, was it a sternwheeler or a sidewheeler?
What? Does that really make a difference, Steve? It was a steamboat with a goddamn army on board. It was then that a fusillade of bullets come raining down from on high. And those vigilantes who accompanied me weren't anywhere to be found. But among those men that were shooting at me, I thought I saw some familiar faces.
Sounds like you don't give up too easy.
That's the kind of man I am, Ben. I set out to do something, I do it. Surrender just ain't in my nature. Plus, I'm stubborn as hell. About then, much to my relief, the vigilantes finally arrived. Their leader motioned at a cabin in the middle of the top deck, pointing me directly at the Daltons. I finally had them, after months of dogged pursuit. But it turned out that they had me.
Take him out! I'm sending you to hell!
Damn. Get the monster over there.
The Daltons had played me like a fiddle. Apparently, the vigilantes were on their damn payroll. They didn't just want to shoot me. They wanted to burn me alive. But finding my way out of a burning labyrinth proved to be quite a challenge.
It was a riverboat, right? I mean, it's not like it was a goddamn ocean liner.
Oh, yeah, but I was in a fight.
Did you hear about that ship that's gonna launch next year? Not just me and
you're talking about the Titanic. If you ask me, it's too blessed to. I don't think
so. So anyway,
don't be stupid, Steve. They know what they're doing. They say that the Titanic is unsinkable.
Oh God.
But getting back to that steamboat, how'd you get off it, Mr. Green?
I took in a lot of smoke that day, so I admit my recollection might be a bit hazy. But somehow I managed to finally disembark. It was time to settle this once and for all.
Let's go.
has been someone over here.
Come at me one at a time. They were in this together. Two brothers side by side, determined to take me down. Confident that this time the odds were on their side. Got it wrong. A sad end for those two. If they'd only known that Emmett was still alive despite his wounds. Paroled 14 years later, he moved to California and sold real estate and lived off the legend of that fateful day. And the tragic death of his two brothers. My own brothers died tragically as well, truth be told. It was 1868, and me and my older brothers were pulling a tidy profit running cattle into Juarez, Mexico. One night after my brothers retired for the evening, I found a little poker game in a cantina with a couple of cowboys. And I just couldn't lose. I even won an old Spanish coin that had to be 100 years old. Well, I was mighty pleased with myself the next morning as my brothers and I rode for Texas. But before we crossed the border, those cowboys caught up with us. It was Johnny Ringo, Roscoe Bob Bryant, and another asshole named Jim. They wanted their money back and everything else we had. Including our lives, as those boys didn't want us coming for them later. Bob put that old Spanish coin in my mouth and said, "I won't have it said that I left you with nothing, boy." Well, those horses bolted, and there we hung as those bastards rode away. The branch finally snapped under the weight of the three of us, but being my older brothers were bigger and heavier, they were already dead. And right then, I swore to myself that I would avenge them. Ringo, you know about. But Bob eluded me until I heard he was riding with the Wild Bunch.
Damn.
I'd been on their trail for months, ever since they left their hideout in the Bighorn Mountains.
Let's finish the stream air for the moment. So thank you for watching, everybody, and see you next time. Bye.